So this is Gardening Unplugged, and I'm going to talk about the soil amendments that we use at Plant Delights, well, Juniper Level Botanic Gardens, to get our soil in such a way that we can grow the range of plants. Right now, over 24,000 kinds of plants that we're able to grow here. So I'll be talking specifically to our normal garden compost beds, which is most of the soil here. First, a little bit about what we try to achieve. We want a pH between 6.2 and 6.5. That is where the largest range of nutrients are available to plants. We're looking for good drainage, and that's why most of our beds are raised. We're looking for about 50% organic matter in the soil. So it's a 50-50 mix, essentially. We make our own compost on site. The leaves that we rake up, the twigs and stems that we cut off here in the nursery and in the gardens, and then Garner ships all of their leaves that they pull off the street. They ship them out here, and that's good for about 3,000 yards a year. We compost that here, and we mix it 50% with our native soil. And our native soil being right here, kind of a coastal plain sand, but then mixing on this property with what is getting into some of that Raleigh clay. We had trucked in a bunch of Raleigh red clay, the reddest that there is. But what we do is essentially, however we siphon it, it ends up being 50% soil, 50% compost. Once we have that, we are looking for, again, that 6.2 to 6.5 pH. We're looking for a favorable calcium to magnesium ratio. Usually about, I believe it's 5.5 to 1 to 8 to 1, calcium being the larger one, magnesium being the smaller one. We like a phosphorus index above 60. We like a potassium index above 60. And these are all numbers that you'll get from your soil test when you send them in to NC State. It is, sometimes of the year, it is a free service. Other times of the year, it's about $3 a sample, I think. And that's a steal. That is a good deal. We have a class here in October, I think it's October, about how to, it's called the World of Soils class. And it'll tell you more about the soil. It'll tell you how to read the soil sample report that you get back and how to act on it. When we act on our soil reports, we use these five and sometimes a sixth product. I'll go down the line. If our pH is too low, you need to raise it. So we put in lime. And that's a pretty common thing. Oh, put some lime on it. Okay, let's put some lime on it. But which kind? There are two kinds of lime out there. One that is easy and cheap to get, and that is dolomitic lime. Dolomitic lime will raise your pH, and it will add calcium to your soil, but it will benefit magnesium over calcium in your calcium to magnesium ratio. So if your magnesium is already too high in the soil compared to your calcium, and keep in mind both of them are, they're cations, so they're both fighting for the same part of the soil colloid. They're both fighting to grab onto that same spot. So if there's too much of one, it's going to kick the other out. So if the calcium to magnesium ratio needs more calcium than magnesium, dolomitic limestone is not what you want. You need calcitic lime. Harder to find, more expensive, but very much worth it. They're going to try to, most people have no idea what that means, including Lowe's and Home Depot. They have no idea what that means. They say put some lime on it, and they all think it's one kind. It is difficult to find calcitic lime outside of places like Green Resource, White Corollas, I think, has it. But more of a farm supply or nursery supply store. It's not overly expensive. This is about a $14 or $15 bag. You're going to put it down at a pretty heavy rate, probably 25 to 50 pounds per 1,000 square feet. So one of these bags for 1,000 square feet. That's going to raise your pH. Next, rock phosphate. I was talking about why we brought in red clay versus just using the infinite amount of soil that we have. Coastal plain sand is incredibly high in phosphorus. It's full of phosphorus already. You can pretty much make matches out of it. It lacks potassium, but it has all the phosphorus it needs. So the native soil right here where we're standing has plenty of phosphorus. So we generally don't have to use much rock phosphate here, but if you live where there is Raleigh red clay, your soil sample will probably come back telling you that your phosphorus index is below 60, therefore less than ideal, and you'll need to bump it up with some phosphorus. And this is the organic way to do that. And I should have said before, all of these products are organic soil amendments. What we find, and honestly, I would just look around, the results speak for themselves. Feed the soil, and the soil will feed your plants a lot better than you can feed the plants yourself. So we feed the soil. We build a soil that is capable of growing plants. And organic is the best way to do that. Not just the best way to feel good about what you're doing or the most environmentally friendly way to do it. It is literally the best way to have healthy soil, and it's the best way to grow good plants. Tony Avent, the owner, puts it, he says, if you can feed a kid a lot of candy bars and it'll make a bigger kid, but don't necessarily make a healthy kid. And the same goes for plants and salt-based fertilizer. You can feed them salt-based fertilizer, it'll make them bigger, but it doesn't necessarily make them healthier.
Jeremy,
yes.
Superphosphate.
Yeah, TSP, triple superphosphate.
No good.
Oh, it's going to bump your phosphorus up. Write down this book. I remember that this book goes into very good detail about why it is not a good thing when used really more than once. It's called An Acres USA Primer. I found it on Amazon a while back. An Acres USA primer has a section about phosphorus, has a section about calcium and magnesium, all those things. It reads like a textbook. Each chapter is nicely segmented, so you can pick it up, read about what you want to read about, and then put it right back down. But it was written, I think, in the 70s or 80s, before really the teeth of the environmental movement had really sunk into the industry. But it is written very scientifically. They use small words where they could have used big words, so I can even read it. And it tells you exactly what you need to know about why feeding the soil is better than trying to feed the plants. Even weed control, how to control your weeds. It's very well detailed about in there, where it has to do with why soil drainage is so important for weed control. I had no idea, but it really goes into detail. So anyway, An Acres USA Primer. See if you can find that. It's worth it. It's worth the $13 it costs to get it. TSP, I think, is a little bit, I think it ends up causing you to have less phosphorus than you did before. I think it's kind of like a diabetic is with sugar. You know, if you have too much sugar, you got too much sugar, and then now you don't have enough sugar. And I think, as I recall, that's kind of what the book goes into about the triple superphosphate. So if you've got Raleigh red clay, chances are you will need phosphorus. Green sand, and it's literally sand that is green. And if y'all want to, you can pick these cups up if you want. Just take a look at them, feel them. Take pictures of the bags, because this is a Espoma company. Green Resource, White Corals, I think, are the places that we get these products. Green sand is for potassium. It has a yield of 0.1, whereas your bag of 10-10-10 is 10% potassium, 10% phosphorus, 10% nitrogen. This is 0.1%. But this is feeding the soil. That 0.1% is far greater than a plant will ever need as a percentage in the soil. It is available to plants, and in the right circumstances, it does not leach. So you throw green sand down, and it takes a few months to really become available to plants. It's not a right-away thing, but you're feeding the soil, and you're building the soil so that the soil grows your plants. This will also raise your pH. Potassium has a positive charge, a strong one at that. Then you got elemental sulfur. When we need to lower pH, because when you are adding triple shred all the time, your mulch, leaf mulch, shredded bark mulch, all those mulches, the pH of the soil tends to come back up over time. Our native soil here is 3.1 to 5.5, very, very low compared to that 7.0 neutral. But when you add organic matter, it tends to start to come back up. And so sometimes we need to bump it down. You will use this sparingly, usually about 5 to 10 pounds per 1,000 square feet. Wear something that you can throw away, because you will smell like sulfur 3 showers out. I know this from experience, and I really don't like using it, but it is the organic way to lower your pH, and it is effective in doing it. It also adds sulfur to the soil, which is a good thing for plants. Instead of adding salt-based nitrogen, we use plant tone. And plant tone, not only does it feed the soil just with the naturally occurring nitrogen that is in it, it's basically like concentrated weaponized compost is what it is. It's not cheap, and you're going to put it down a bag per 1,000 square feet, about 50 pounds per 1,000 square feet. But it also has microbes in it. It is a living product. You throw this down, you are feeding the soil with microbes. And so this is a great way. You cannot burn your plants. You could grow a tomato right out of this bag, from what I've heard. I haven't tried it myself. The only thing here, actually, that you can really burn your plants with by putting too much down is sulfur. Even the cal lime, the calcitic lime, if you put too much down, your pH is just too high. But the only one you're really going to burn your plants with, if you're not careful, is sulfur. The others are pretty easy to use. So if we need a bump of nitrogen, we throw down plant tone. Sometimes if we have put compost down in the garden that isn't quite finished yet, because we don't have manure to throw in and mix with our compost, so we turn it every 2 weeks 7 times. If it's not completely finished by that time and it has cooled down, in other words, the food that the microbes are eating to break it down is now gone, then we can use a little bit of plant tone in there. We'll mix plant tone into the unfinished compost, and that'll cook it a little faster. It'll get it back going again. But these are the things that we use. And again, feel free to pick up the cup, check them out. Consider signing up for our World of Soils class in October. It's going to go into more depth about what's going on in the soil. What is ideal? Why is it ideal? What does that mean to have good soil? And again, how to read your soil tests. And Acres USA Primer. I can't say enough good things about that book. You will learn a lot from it. You will be better gardeners for it. Any questions?
So in the calendar that was included in the catalog, it said to amend all year round.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any specific points for that?
There is never a wrong time to put any one of these products down. Salt-based fertilizer, there can be, yes. You put it down in the middle of winter when things are not growing, you've lost it because it's a salt. Rains like this, it's gone. It's in the groundwater. The only thing I would caution against would be something like the elemental sulfur. If you need to drop your pH and it's a dewy morning, and your hosta leaves are as big as they're going to get, and then the sulfur sticks to the leaves, it could burn them a little bit superficially. But other than that, there is no wrong time of year to apply this. There's no wrong time of year to test your soil either. Any other questions? Cool.
10-10-10. Don't use it.
If you got to use it, you got to use it. I've used it in my garden. It don't overuse it. I like a candy bar now and then.
What time of year do you put it down?
Usually I use it, honestly, I like to use it during the growing season for warm season things. Usually the cool season things don't struggle from poor nutrition that I have seen. But your warm season things, I like to put it down when I see the storm clouds just about on site. So I will hear the thunder and I will walk out, and I'll just take a Dixie cup like you see here, and I'll sprinkle it around, and then it immediately gets rained in. That's the way I like to roll with it.
Okay.